This video is the second part of a mini tutorial on using MATLAB and psychophysics to create simple psychology experiments. Today, I will show you an example of a choice reaction time task that has almost all the elements of a psychology experiment that you would want to put up. For that, we will go to MATLAB to run the demonstration. On my desktop, I have a folder called Choice Reaction Time. I have also opened my MATLAB window. When you start out with MATLAB, by default, it's going to go to your user folder under MATLAB. What you would like to do is to change the directory so that MATLAB will be able to find the script you have for the experiment. The simplest way to do this is to drag the folder that you have into the MATLAB command window. That's the equivalent to typing out the command CD or change directory into the directory. I also want to show you what's in my folder here. In my folder, there are three files. There's a MATLAB script with the suffix .m, and there are two JPEG files that this script will be reading. So let's take a look. The command what will show you all of the scripts or mex files that you have access to. This I find to be a useful command. The command pwd is present working directory. It tells you where you are. This is helpful too for you to identify whether you're running the right script from the right folder. So to run this command, we would type out the name of the script, okay, without the suffix. So you don't put .m here. In our case, the name of the script is choice.rt. So I typed out the name of the script. So let's return. You can see my program is set up to have a prompt for the user to enter information, particularly the participant's number, age, gender, the group that they come from. Here I put control here. And in our experiment, we have a number of blocks. So I have a field that allows the experimenter to change the number of blocks. For our purposes, I'm going to change this into 2. We're just going to run 2 blocks. So once that's entered, we're going to click OK. Okay. So the first thing you see here is a text presented on the screen that gives some information to the experimenter and to the participants what they want to do. You can make the instruction complex, but here I made something very simple. It says you should report the color of the star. It also tells the experimenter that they need to press the spacebar to start the experiment. So let's press the spacebar. Okay, now you see another instruction that tells you what to do. Here it says we're going to click to start the block. Okay, it also says we're supposed to make keyboard responses by pressing the left arrow if you see a red stimulus, or the right arrow if you see a blue stimulus. So I'm going to put my fingers on the left and the right arrow. And I'm going to click to start, okay? Okay, so now the first one that shows up is red. So the instruction said I should respond by pressing the left button. So I'm going to press left. Okay, as soon as I made the response, you hear a sound that indicates that my response was correct, okay? And the next trial starts by presenting another red star, so I'll press left. Left. Okay, now this trial shows a blue star, and I'm supposed to press the red button corresponding to blue, so I'll press right. Okay, so what if I make the wrong response, okay? What if when it's blue and I accidentally press the red, okay? All right, so you can hear that the program buzzed, okay? It gives a different feedback, suggesting that the program is actually evaluating whether my response is correct or not. Another thing you might want to ask is, what happens if I press something else? Okay, this is what I'm doing now. I'm pressing other buttons on the keyboard. You can see nothing happens. So the program is smart enough to wait for just one of the two responses, which is the left and the right arrow keys. Okay, this is an important way to avoid errors in the experiment, so people don't accidentally press the wrong button. When they press the wrong button, they are actually inaccurate in indicating whether it's red or blue. So let's continue with these trials. So red is left. Okay, so that just ends the first block. So in that block, I showed a few trials with red or blue stars in random order, and the participants are supposed to press the left or the right arrow corresponding to the color, okay? In this next block here, the instruction tells me that I'm supposed to make a mouse response. Okay, I'm going to click the left side of the mouse button for a red star and make a right click for a blue star. Okay, so let's start. So now, this time, if I click the left or the right arrow button, this is how I made the response earlier, and I'm doing that now, you can see nothing happens. So the computer is waiting for a mouse response. So since it's blue, I click right. Okay, so let's just go over this. Just like before, if I make the wrong response, this is red. If I click the right mouse button, you can see that it buzzes, and actually, you might have noticed that there is a pause. Okay, there is a timeout, or an error delay of about a second that's built into the program. This is just to give participants a chance to recover from the error that they just made. Okay, so I just finished running this simple experiment. Before we go back to our presentation window, I want to show you what this has done to my folder. Earlier, I showed you that in my folder, I had three files. My script file and the two JPEG files corresponding to the red and the blue star that was displayed to participants. Now you can see a fourth file presented here. This is a new file that was just created by the program. Okay, it's called Choice Reaction Time. It has the gender that we put in at the prompt. It's a female, participant number 98, comes from a control group with the age of 18. Okay, so we can take a look at this file and see what it does. Okay, so this is a file that was generated from MATLAB. Let me try to make this a little bigger so you can see better on the video. So essentially what this file does is it recorded the data from each of the 20 trials that I went through. 10 trials for the keyboard response and 10 trials for the mouse response. So you can see from the top, I have a row that recorded the variable names corresponding the participant ID, their age, their gender, the group that they came from. And then I also have variables that correspond to the different experimental variables. Okay, so I recorded what the participants were making a keyboard or a mouse response. I also recorded the block number. We've only run two blocks, so they go in one and two. But if I had run this experiment longer for eight blocks, you're going to see this number going all the way to eight. There is also a variable called trial number. It essentially goes from the first trial to the 10th trial within each experimental block, and then it resets again. This variable here is important. It records the stimulus that was presented to participants, whether it's red or blue. Okay. And the next column here, I recorded the accuracy, whether I made the correct or the incorrect response. And you might remember that we deliberately made an error in the keyboard phase as well as an error in the mouse phase. And the last column here corresponds to reaction time, that is how long it has taken me to make that response. And for some trials I was talking, so you can see the response time is long. This is in milliseconds, so it took about 8 seconds for me to make the first response, and so on. You may have also noticed that there are things that varied in the experiment that I didn't record. Okay, this is something we'll talk about in subsequent assignments. Ideally, you want to record as much information as you can, even information that you don't think will be useful for your particular experiment. You may find it useful in the future. So one thing that's obviously that I neglected to put in the recording phase is the position of the star. Okay, you may have noticed the star was random on the screen. It wasn't always in the middle. So that's actually something that I should have recorded, because when a star shows up in the middle of the screen, maybe people are faster than when it's say in the far upper left or upper right, is in the far peripheral regions of the display. And that would be a variable that can account for some of the variability in reaction time. So let's go back to our presentation. Now that you've seen what this program does, I want to point out a few things that this very simple code does that's common among most or all of psychology experiments. You have noticed in the beginning there is a prompt for experimenter input, okay, that includes the participants' information, typically their age and gender, the group that they come from, or some other variables that you would like to input as an experimenter. There is going to be, as I'll show you in the next video, there are commands that allow you to create a file in order to write out the data. And that's the data file we looked at a moment ago. That file was created by the MATLAB program that's recording what happened on a trial-by-trial basis. We also use the screen function. This is an important and yet somewhat complex function. that displays visual presentation, and it gives fairly good control over when you display something and for how long it's presented on the display and so on. So in our case, we presented either the red or the blue star in random positions. In addition, you may have noticed when the screen function shows up, it blocked everything else out, right? You were no longer able to see for instance, my desktop. Okay, so the screen function essentially took control of the monitor, disabling or not allowing you to see anything else that's going on in your computer. Okay, well, another thing that you may have noticed in the experiment is some randomization, right? The red and the blue stars are unpredictable, okay? It's hard for people to know which one is going to come up next. This randomization procedure is really important in psychology experiments because oftentimes we want to randomize and counterbalance the number of trials per condition, but we don't want people to know which condition is going to come up next. In addition, in this program, we've asked participants to make a keyboard or a mouse response, and the program was able to receive the response, record the response, figuring out on a trial-by-trial basis whether the response is correct or not, and present feedback corresponding to that. And finally, this is an important part, that the data coming from the participants and what was presented to them in the experiment was written out into a file. So these are components that you will find to be shared with other experiments as well. And in the next video, I will explain the codes that went into this choice reaction time task and tell you how these various aspects of the task were implemented in the code. Okay.